Sleep. church. How we doing? Good morning. Did everybody have a good Christmas? Did Santa come see everybody? Okay, good, good, good. Are we ready to worship? We're getting close to a new year. Nobody talk about 2021, though, okay? We're just going to go in real quiet. Everybody go in real quiet, okay?
The power of our God.
Father's house. Amen. And sometimes on this journey, get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength. My story isn't over, my story's just begun. Failure won't define me, cause that's what my Father does. Come on, sing it out. Sing, failure won't define me, cause that's what my Father does. Ooh, lay your burdens down. Shame at the door, sin ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house. Yeah. Arrival's not the end game, the journey's where you are. Just fall in my heart. And the story isn't over, if the story isn't good, failure's never mine, oh, and the Father's in the room. I said, failure's never mine, oh, and the Father's in the room.
Love is and love is and love is breaking through. Where the shame at the door, cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's
working. Never stop.
No. you're working. Even when I don't feel that you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop, no. You're always a maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
Good morning. You all may be seated. There we go. Didn't know where I was there for a second. Hope you all had a wonderful Christmas. I'm very glad to be back. I know Christmas was tough for our family as we had a lot of adjustments to make. It seemed every day leading up through the week to get to Christmas Day, our plans were getting cut shorter and shorter and became more virtual and less in person. But even with that, and even though I know that's how a lot of us experience the holidays, I feel like we're blessed to be able to come here this morning and still gather as this family and be able to come and worship. So I do pray, though, that as COVID seems to be becoming more unpredictable, even though we do have a vaccine and we're seeming to have good news, that we're still practicing caution here. But also remembering that even with COVID, we still have opportunities to go and share the gospel and to be stuck in our homes with people, to not lose those opportunities of evangelism and discipleship there. So as blessed as we are to be able to meet here, know that that mission continues as we go back into our homes. And even when you're working from home, whether in a Zoom meeting or whatever it is, don't forget to reach out to those that are grandparents that are locked away, or people that are having to quarantine for 7, 10, 2 weeks, however long, that we don't forget about those people. So as blessing as it is to be here today, we are thinking about those that are having to watch online and have been having to watch online. We love you. We care about you. And we haven't forgot about you, and we're praying for y'all as well. Let's pray this morning. Father, we are thankful. Even as we come out of the Christmas season, Father, don't let us forget about the miracle. Father, don't let us forget about just the time where you interceded human history to take care of our problem that we couldn't fix, that we were very much guilty of. Father, you sent your son, Father, knowing that he would live 33 years to have to become the perfect sacrifice in our place. Father, it's not something that's only celebrated within a season. Father, I pray that we never lose sight of that, but it's something that's constantly on our minds. When we think about ourselves, when we think about others, when we think about this church, Father, when we look about the world around us and all the problems, where it's not just COVID, but people being locked in their homes and people being angry and politics and all of these different areas of life that seem to become more tense due to COVID. Father, I pray that we never lose sight of the hope that we have and the peace and joy of resting in that hope that Christ has come and he did die for our sins and that he is returning. It has always been true and it will be true, and we can look forward to that. We can trust you in that. So Father, I pray for those that are going through COVID now, Father, those that have lost people due to it, and Father, those that are living in fear or just living cautious, Father, I pray that you would bring us peace and joy. Father, for those of us that are able to travel or able to go into work or able to just be around other people, Father, I pray that we would make those opportunities to not just take for granted, but to be representing you in those moments as well. So, Father, we thank you for this beautiful day and in this time that you've blessed us with to be able to meet together and worship you this morning. Father, I pray that as Jerry preaches, Father, we would hear your word for what it is, your word to us, so that we would know you more and to love you more, so that we can take that to others. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Well, let's see if I can remember the announcement list, because everything had to do with Christmas, and then we got there, and now I'm not so sure what our church is supposed to do now. So I'm just going to make up some stuff, and we'll add it to the calendar later. No, I'm not doing that, because that would stress me out. However, if you want to help me out, not personally, but help our youth group out, because we really are, you know, the favorite ministry of the church for sure. We do have some more pecans out here. No longer halved. Sorry for those pecan roasters. But pecan pie lovers, we've got you set. We've still got, oh, I don't know, maybe 15 to 20 bags of chopped pecans left. And we're going to give them to you for a deal, which I'm now going to ask Jamie Witt what that deal is. Did we, were we, you want to go, should we go half price or... Hold on. What do you think? Half price? Cool. What's that, seven? No. $8 a bag. We're going to give them to you for $8 a bag. And if you call us right now, then I'm probably not going to answer because I'm in church. But they'll be here for you. So text me, and I'll see what I can do. It's disrespectful, but maybe I can, you know, hit you up. So we are still selling pecans. It is a new year, but with COVID, it doesn't really feel that way. But we are so glad for those of you that have been watching online, the guests that we have, and the ones that we've had, the brave ones of you that have gone and visited other churches in COVID. I mean, shouts out to y'all. I mean, they hired me, so I'm here. But, you know, y'all, like, chose to get out of your house and come visit, and I think that's wonderful. So let's just prepare our hearts this morning for worship. And with that, I'm going to hand it off to our pastor, Jerry.
Good morning, and for those of you that are not familiar with Argo Christian Fellowship, we don't just sell nuts at random. I mean, it's not like we're the pecan headquarters of Argo. The nuts are going for the youth department to get to Strength to Stand in Pigeon Forge or Gatlinburg. I don't really know which is which, if it's the same or one of the same or pretty close, but kids are going to Strength to Stand in January, and our youth group, it's going to help them. They're going to have a great time, and I'd ask you to be in prayer for them as they get ready to go. We had a little theft from one of our vans that we discovered this past week. Someone stole the catalytic converter out of one of our vans, so the kids, we got to get that fixed, because the kids... Kids got to get to Gatlinburg. And so, with that being said, the pecans are now $15 a bag. Vroom, vroom. Oh, my goodness. I'm just kidding. They're whatever they said they are. And hey, it is great to see all of you this morning. I hope you've had a very Merry Christmas. And it is going to be a, and I'm just going to declare it and say that declaring it will make it so. It's going to be a happy new year. Happy, happy new year. I know that just going from one year to the next is not going to make a difference. But boy, last year at this time, we had no way of knowing what the year had in store for us. It was a great year. I'll tell you how it started, and if I can take responsibility for this, I absolutely will. But I think it started last year. We were preparing for our Christmas Eve service, and it just kind of set the whole world off its axis, maybe, with this one issue. We have a dear lady in our first service who decorates at different seasons, and Christmas, Thanksgiving especially. But at Christmas, she had brought in three wise men on camels, and she had decorated the front table with them. And it was just absolutely beautiful display. But in getting ready for the Christmas Eve service, my son and I, Gabe, were moving the table, and we were moving it ever so carefully. I thought, in my ignorance, this is one of the things that I do too much of, I assumed that those camels and the wise men on them were metal. They looked like they were metal, so I thought they were metal. So we're shuffling this table out of the way to clear the space out for the Christmas Eve service, and one of the camels fell over and broke. They're not metal. So I'm like, oh my goodness, I gotta go tell this lady I've broken her camel. So I did. I went and confessed up. I said, broke your camel. We're gonna try and glue it. She said, don't worry about it. Everything I take down there, I know has to be pastor proof. And so if you destroy it, you know, it's not a big deal. Don't worry about it. What about it? Well, I can't just not worry about it, right? So Sandy went to glue it at home, and she accidentally dropped it as she went to glue it, and it shattered into 1,000 pieces. So, that's why I wasn't one of the wise men going to see Jesus with the gifts, because I'm like, I'm sorry I dropped your frankincense and myrrh out in front, but I'll go get you some more, you know. So I looked online all year long, periodically, at least once a month, I'd check online, scan, try and find this camel. Got to find this camel that matched this set, and I found out that it was sold in the 90s, and, I looked for even one that were kind of close that we could just paint, you know, and make it look like these other two camels, make it look like a metal camel with a wise man on it. So finally, in late November, lo and behold, I opened up my computer and I did a search, and there was one in Indiana for sale, just one of the three. It was the exact one we needed. I couldn't believe it. It was a Christmas miracle. So I bought it, and it arrived the week before Christmas, and it came in the package, and I'm like, I don't know what this package is. And it rattled, you know, you shake it and it rattles. I opened it up. It's a broken camel. Lord have mercy. So Sandy and I, we laid out all the soft blankets that we have in our house and pillows, and we glued it back together. Sandy got it all back together. She even painted on it to match it, made it look. And so yesterday we took those three camels back. The other two had laid in the corner of my office all year long, safe and secure and sound. And we carried them back over to her, and we said, presented her with her three camels. And I hope I never see those camels again. So that's the Christmas story. And I think that's what just kind of ruined the whole year. It just set everything off. Hey, when you start messing with the wise men, there's no telling what you've unleashed on the earth. So I apologize, and I am so sorry. But this morning, we are going to take about the next 20 minutes, and we're going to think and reflect on what communion is and what it means. And it's very, very important, because in so much of the Christian life, there is getting to be less and less of reverence. And we take here at Argo Christian Fellowship, we observe communion the second Sunday of every month. And it's not something that I think you want to be just, it's good that it's on the schedule, but I don't like it to be just so familiar and you just go through it as if it means nothing and you don't reflect on it and you don't really think about it. So I like to take two or three times out of the year and really think about it and do the whole service around communion, and that's what we're going to do this morning. And it kind of reminds us communion, kind of reminds me of brokenness. I mean, you think about a broken camel. I mean, it's the reason Jesus came, because the world was broken, because it was broken through Adam and Eve and their sin in the Garden of Eden, and that had such impact that it impacted every person that was ever born, you and I, and we were born broken. We were born broken in our fellowship with God. We're born broken in sin. And so this is, for us as followers of Jesus Christ, this is a reminder that our brokenness has been restored and that God loves us even in our brokenness. Even in our brokenness. So if you are at home this morning, I encourage you to get some elements, get something to signify the juice and something to signify the bread. And we'll be taking communion here in just a moment. 1 Corinthians chapter 11 is where we're going to be reading from this morning. It's a familiar passage of Scripture. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and it says this, verse number 23. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever, therefore, eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and the blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. This is why many of you are ill and weak, and some have even died. So there is our blueprint for why we take communion. And the first thing that we're going to look at is the third thing that is listed there, the third main thought in this passage of Scripture. Now, this is Paul reflecting on communion, and he's writing this to the Corinthian church. And the Corinthian church was the most dysfunctional church of the early churches. It was very, very dysfunctional as far as the churches of that time. Now, anywhere there's people, anywhere that we gather, there's going to be dysfunctionality in our homes, in our churches. You know, we're not perfect, but that Corinthian church was kind of unique in its total dysfunction. And they were to a point where the rich people, they would plan for communion and observing the Lord's table, and the rich people would get there because they didn't have to work, and they had people that worked for them, and they would gather early, and they would eat all the food, and then the other people that worked and that were not as privileged as them, they would show up, and there'd be no food left. And all the people they would show up to was everybody was drunk and just passed out from eating and drinking. And so they had totally abused what this means. So Paul is giving them instruction, and he's reflecting on something that Jesus did with his disciples just before his crucifixion, where he took this Passover meal and he proclaimed it as, now it's going to be a part of how you worship me in my absence. And the early church then began to adopt it. And even to this day, they began to adopt it. Our family usually goes on Christmas Eve to a communion service downtown to a church, and we couldn't go this year. They did reservations. We didn't want to take up a reservation of someone that maybe goes to that church, so we didn't go. And then we normally have our communion services here on Christmas Eve. But this morning, as we take of this, I mean, we're practicing something that has been practiced through the centuries in every culture, in every tongue, in all of these different time periods. It has that much of an implication. And the first thought that we have that Paul wants to tell them is this: you've got to be righteous before you take of communion. And he says this is the third thought. It's the last one as he gives. So in verses 27 and 29, he says, let each man examine himself. So we're encouraged to be righteous. So when we take of communion, we're examining our life. We've got to examine our life. The idea here of the interpretation of this is careful scrutiny of yourself. Now, on Sunday morning, we walk in and we all look good. You know, we've combed our hair and we've probably matching, you know, we've picked out what we're going to wear. And so we show up and, you know, we all look good, but we don't know what is on the inside of us. Only you know what's on the inside of us. Or maybe a family member knows, someone very close to you knows what is on the inside of you. But God always knows what's on the inside of us. And so we're encouraged to be righteous. And this is self-examination. So we're thinking about who we are. We're looking deeply and we're looking honestly inside of ourselves. And we're doing this before God and not for other people. So much of our lives, you think about almost everything we do is for someone else. But communion is before the Lord. It is in front of the Lord. And we do it before God. And so we examine ourselves because He is our audience of one when we take communion. And understand this, righteousness is according to God's standard and not man's standard. Now, you know the world has a different standard of righteousness. They become tolerance and acceptance of all things. But here's the thing about God and about His word. My opinion doesn't matter about righteousness, and nor does yours, nor does anybody else's. Only God's word, only God Himself has the standard for righteousness. And He lays it out and says, this is the righteousness. You know, 2020 has been a sad way and has been a difficult and sad year in so many ways, but there have been so many that have fallen morally in different ways, but have fallen morally in the flesh that are some of our most celebrated Christian leaders in America. And I was talking with a friend of mine who's a pastor here in the area, and he said, well, that guy, we're talking about a guy, he goes, that guy doesn't surprise me at all. I mean, you just look at him and go, I don't know what he's doing, but it didn't surprise me at all with him. And we talked about some others, and it did surprise us. When do we think about our righteousness before God? Not that we're the applause of man and the applause of people or how many are in the crowd. That means absolutely nothing, but our righteousness. And so when we take this communion, we look inside of ourselves. And we look inside so at the attitude and the hearts and the thoughts, but we can also look at the outside of our life, our habits, our behavior, how we treat other people, the life that we live. And even Paul tells these people, the Corinthians, some of you are sick and some of you have died because you took of the blood and the cup in an unworthy manner. Now, you think that's not true? I guarantee it's true today. Some are sick and some are dead because they took of the cup in an unworthy manner. That's how serious it is. Not examining yourselves and being right with the Lord when you take of the body of the blood of Christ, it can be detrimental to your health. That's how serious it is. You know, our God is holy. And this is an aspect of God that we cannot understand. If you were asked, okay, describe God. Okay, describe Jesus. Describe the Holy Spirit. What is their function? What do they do? How are they expressed in each of those three manifestations of the one God, the triune God, in three ways? What are each of those? The first thing we would say about God is that He is absolute holiness. Absolute holiness. He's incapable of evil and sin. In other words, He will never falter. He's incapable of it. Isaiah 57:15 says this, the one who is high and lifted up, who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy. It says even His name is holy. And around His throne, what are the cherubs doing? What are the angels doing? They're proclaiming, holy is the Lord God of hosts. Over and over and over again, God is holy. So God's holiness has two parts. It has perfect righteousness and it has perfect justice. So God is absolute righteousness and perfection, not just hasn't sinned, but incapable of sin, of wrong. So it's impossible for God to do anything wrong or to have fellowship with anything that is less than His perfect righteousness. So here comes sinful man. God can no longer have relationship with sinful man. Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, so Adam and the death that passed upon all men, this inherited brokenness, when we arrived in the mail, we were broken. We were broken. But God, through His Son Jesus Christ, enabled us to be holy and righteous again. So His perfect justice acts together with His perfect righteousness. He can't be partial or unfair to any creature, and He must deal with the creature in perfect justice. So we're held to a standard, and given to a standard now is through Jesus Christ. So a holy God declares us righteous through Jesus Christ. Now, as holy, as righteous, and righteous as God is, what does that look like for His people? When you examine yourself, when you examine your family, do we also exhibit that same amount of righteousness? Do we care about His righteousness? Have we adopted our own righteousness that we say, well, this is how we can live, and this is what we can do, and it's okay to think this, and it's okay to be this, and it's okay to practice this? Well, it might be according to the world's standards, but not according to God's standard. It is His standard that matters and not ours. So at communion, we take our life and we examine it. And we expose it before God. So we lay it out. We lay it out. Two kinds of righteousness. The first one, declared righteous, which we talked about. We're declared righteous through Jesus Christ. Everyone that is born again or has repented of their sin and asked Jesus Christ for forgiveness and taken upon their life that forgiveness that is offered freely through Jesus Christ, made Him the Lord of their life. So then God says that you are declared righteous, or the theological term that we would use from the book of Romans is imputed righteousness. So it is positional righteousness. But then there is also another part of righteousness, and that is our own daily righteousness. See, we just can't say, well, we're forgiven, and then we can live any way we want. We still have choices, and we still have control over what we do and what we think and who we are and how we live our lives. So this is practical righteousness. And you know, there's sins that all of us are prone to. Sins that are all of us are prone to. I don't know how it was this week that everywhere I went, I got behind somebody slow. It didn't matter where I went. I went to Pell City. I was behind somebody. They had their blinker on since like 69, I think. It was blinking right, and then all of a sudden they turned to blinking left, and I was waiting for a no-passing zone so I could pass them. And you know, I just have these horrible thoughts of wishing I had like an old World War II military truck that I could just push them out of the way. And it's sad, you know, that you get like that. But it didn't matter. I was trying to go down Highway 11, which is now a parking lot. And I told them that. This is not a parking lot. This is a U.S. Highway 31. It's a federal highway. 55, Jack, 55. Oh, my stars. You know, there's those sins that we're just prone to where we just get, and Sandy's always like, they don't hear you. They don't hear you. I say, yeah, but they can see me gesturing in good ways, practicing my preaching. So they're the sins that we're all prone to, but then there's also the sins that are unique to women, and there's sins that are unique to men. And what are those sins? I know what sins are unique to a man. We battle those. We examine now this morning those sins. So here we are in God's house before God, about to take of His bread and His blood, and we are exposing the darkest part of ourselves before God and saying, I'm sorry, forgive me. I want to take of this cup and this blood and righteousness, because that's what it's given to me, and I want to give that same righteousness back to you. In this moment, I want to be right with you. And you know, righteousness is a quality of life. It improves the quality of your life. You look at anybody that's not righteous, it totally ruins relationships. They lose jobs over it. They lose friends over it. They become susceptible to all kinds of horrible habits in their life because they've exposed themselves, and they're absolutely not happy. Righteousness brings happiness. It is a quality of life. Think about just the Ten Commandments. The first four are given in how we live before God, so you can be right with God. This is what God says, these first four things. Then the six are given so that we can live peaceably with other people. So we have that righteousness before God vertically, and that righteousness with God horizontally for those next six things. And you follow that, and your life will be better. So the first thing we're to do is to carefully examine ourselves. The next thing, verses 23 to 25, is we're encouraged to reflect, to remember. This at Christmas time, I always think about past memories. Think about past Christmases. you sit around and you think about when the kids were little and when they were when they got this and when they got that, and when you surprised them with this, when you surprised them with that. I mean, it's just so fun. And you're seeing the kids open up their gifts, and it's all kind of culminates, and you're awash with all those memories every Christmas that you take. But we remember those good times. But this is remembering the best time. The best time. This is the memory that our debt was paid and how it was paid and who paid it. What Christ did for us. Where we were declared righteous and we were granted salvation, forgiveness through Him. And our salvation, it encompasses the total work of God for sinful man. Deliverance from the condemnation and the power of sin. Condemnation and the power of sin. So God, through Jesus Christ, He granted the wealth of all of His grace, which encompasses eternal life, which includes the provision for the abundant life now and the eternal life to come. So there through salvation, and so when we take of this cup and we take of this bread, we're remembering the sacrifice that Jesus Christ made and what it means for us, past, present, and future. Past, present, and future. So it encompasses all of time for every person that knows Christ, saved from the sin's penalty, present deliverance over daily sin and temptation, where that no longer becomes the rule of our life, but the exception, and then the future deliverance into eternal life. Many years ago in 2014, my sister passed away at 47 years old. And it was amazing to this day when I get together with her children and I think about all the time that's passed from 2014 to now. And I see her kids, and now I see their kids, them that she doesn't even know, didn't get to know. They weren't born until after she was gone. I get together with my brother, her husband, Daryl, who we're very, very close with. It is amazing to think about how she has gone from here and all that she has missed. But that really isn't a correct view. The correct view is how much we have missed out on for that time that she has been with the Lord in heaven. So our salvation, and it was her salvation that took her from death to life. It took her from a period of darkness into light. It took her from this earth, this temporal place, to an eternal place. And that's what we remember this morning with communion. We remember Jesus' sacrifice. And lastly, verse number 26, we're reminded that we proclaim the Lord's death until He comes. Every time we take of the Lord's death, we remember the Lord's death, we proclaim that He is going to return. Communion is proclaiming His return. Christ's death, we remember and we proclaim. It is a fact that Jesus will return. We believe that He came as a baby. He lived and died for the sins of man, but also He will return for His own. He will come back. He will not leave us. He will not abandon us. He will keep His promise, and it will be a miraculous event. So we think about living today because He's coming back soon. And I don't know about you, but even so, Lord Jesus, come quickly is the prayer from the Word of God. And I have that same prayer. Through communion, we proclaim His death until He returns. So this is, we do in a moment, but it means of that miraculous moment at His return. We're pointing to that. Luke chapter 12, Jesus gave a parable. And He said this about the master being gone, and it is appropriate for His return. It says in verse 35 of chapter 12, "Stay dressed, ready for action, and keep your lamps burning, and be like men who are waiting for their master to come home from the wedding feast, so that they may open the door to him at once when he comes and knocks. Blessed are those servants whom the master finds awake when he comes. Truly, I say to you, he will dress himself for service and have them recline at table, and he will come and serve them. If he comes in the second watch or in the third and finds them awake, blessed are those servants. But know this, that if the master of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming,
he would not have left his house to be broken into. You also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour that you do not expect. So the third part of our communion experience this morning is that as we partake of this, we're proclaiming his death until he comes again. Well, you should have the elements before you. If you do not, we can get someone, just raise your hand and someone will bring them to you if you're here with us this morning. We must decide to take the bread and drink the wine. It is our choice. It is not forcible on anyone that is present. But remember this, that this is just juice and a little wafer. It is just symbolizes the blood and the broken body. What is real is what it signifies, and that is our salvation, what has happened in our heart where we've received Jesus Christ. And so let's give thanks for his broken body and his shed blood. Heavenly Father, we cannot take of this lightly or flippantly. We've examined ourselves, and we want to take it in a worthy manner, that we would lay our righteousness before you, who is perfect in righteousness and holiness. Father, I pray that you would speak into our lives, that you would speak into our hearts the significance of this moment of your broken body and your shed blood as we remember it and we proclaim your return. Thank you so much for dying on the cross for us, for sinful, broken mankind. We love you, Father. Thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice. Amen. Take and eat, for this is his body, which was broken for you. In the same way, he took the cup and he said, "Take and drink, for as often as you do this, you drink in remembrance of me." Would you stand with me, please? And let's close out this morning with a song of worship and a time of reflection and celebration of Christ's death for us.
Cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. And I see his wounds and his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. Drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still, and all alone. And hope. Forevermore, for endless.
Church, we will see you next week. Thanks for being here.
Mountains are still being moved. Strongholds are still being moved. God, we believe. Yes, we can see that wonders are still what you do. And bodies are still